tests are awesome. They're my favorite bit of software engineering. I'm sure many of you can relate, but I don't tend to trust humans telling me I'm doing well at my job. When a computer tells me I'm doing well at my job though, because I made a test pass, ooh, that dopamine hits good. A good test makes sure that the thing we're building does what we think it should do. This series has a free accompanying book in which you can find all the details for this tutorial. Check the description below. My name is Daniel. Welcome to Iris. Anecdotally, I recently interviewed at a company where I professed my love of tests, and they told me flatly they don't write tests, they move fast. Later in the same interview, they admitted they were having morale issues because their engineers were constantly getting called out of hours to fix things. So it begs the question, are you really moving fast if you have to keep going back to fix your old code? Software engineers aren't paid to write software, we're paid to solve problems. Tests are what make sure we solve the right problem, and by automating our tests, we make sure we don't accidentally unsolve it further down the line. There are many ways to test software. These largely fall into three categories that make up what we call the testing pyramid. It's a pyramid to indicate that although all tests are important, those lower down the pyramid should be laying the foundation for the others. Not only should you have more of them, but they'll provide the greatest feeling of safety and security. End-to-end tests are designed to make sure that the user of the software you've created can complete full user journeys. For example, can the user open, edit, and save a file in a desktop application, or can they add an item to a shopping cart and check out in an e-commerce store? End-to-end tests are the slowest form of tests and lack depth, but they can help add confidence that everything works together. Integration tests check that the code that you control works correctly with code that your program depends on that you don't control. This could include things like databases or other data stores, web APIs, library APIs, etc. Integration tests are also used if your software produces a public API. Because of the communication component to these tests are also quite slow, but you should try to cover every single communication point. Unit tests test a single unit of functionality. These tests are the simplest and the fastest and should make up the bulk of your testing. These tests are so important that it's best practice to write them before you write the code that you're going to test with them. For this video series, we're only going to cover unit tests. That isn't to say that integration tests and end-to-end tests aren't important, they absolutely are, and there are many good guides out there. But it is to say that unit tests are so important that they significantly impact how we communicate about Rust code. This is particularly important for documentation, which we're going to talk about more in the next video. Unlike many languages, in Rust, tests live with the code that they're testing. To explain this, we need to talk about how code in Rust is organized with modules. A module is simply a container for other things. Functions, type definitions, other modules, etc. You could think of it like a physical container, though you can nest any number of containers together. The contents of a module are private to that module unless explicitly marked as public with the pub keyword. Private items can only be accessed inside that module or its submodules. We can define a module with the mod keyword and a name. There are then three ways to define what's inside the module. With a directory named the same thing as the module, which contains the file mod.rs. With a file in the same directory named the same thing as the module, or inside of curly brackets. If the module exposes anything publicly, you can then reference those things with the path to the module and the name of the thing you're referencing, all separated by double colons. Sound familiar? It should. This is how we've been accessing Rust's standard library. For example, the standardin function is inside the IO module, which itself is available inside of the standard library module. We can access that function using std IO standardin. We can also use the use keyword to simplify this a bit. For example, we can use std IO standardin, and then we can use standardin without having to use the full path of the module every single time. In Rust, we typically create a test module in the same file as the code that's being tested. Let's say we want to test some of the split functions we wrote in the last video. I've renamed them a bit so we can have all of them in the same file. First, we start by creating a module to test these functions, which I'm going to put right here. As long as nothing in the test module is used in your main program, it shouldn't appear in your final binary. However, this isn't good enough. There's a risk we might make a mistake, of course, but even without that, the module will still be processed by the compiler in order to do things like type checking every single time. We only care about this module when we're running the tests, and Rust provides a way for us to tell the compiler that too, the configuration attribute, CFG. Attributes are one of Rust's many metaprogramming tools, which we're going to cover in the future. For now, the CFG attribute allows us to tell the Rust compiler, Rust C, when we want to compile something. There are many, many ways to use conditional compilation, but for tests it's pretty simple. We only want the module compiled when we're building tests. The CFG attribute has a predicate to identify this, simply called test. So by adding the CFG attribute with the test predicate, Rust C will ignore the module unless it's explicitly building the tests. Now we're ready to write our first test. A test is simply a function we mark with another attribute, test. This attribute tells Rust to run this function as part of the test suite when we run cargo test. Here's a test that won't pass. The assert macro takes either one or two parameters. The first parameter, which is not optional, is a Boolean value, or something that evaluates to a Boolean. If this Boolean is false, then the assertion will cause a panic and the test will fail. The second, optional parameter, allows us to annotate the assertion, which can help us more easily determine which, if any, assertion failed in a test. This is awesome when we create more thorough tests with more assertions. You will find that people don't use this as much, and I'm guilty of this too, but I do recommend making an effort to describe each specific assertion. The people you work with, as well as future you, will appreciate the effort. There are three main assert macros. Assert asserts that the value is true or panics with an optional message. Assert EQ asserts that left is equal to right or panics with an optional message. And assert NE asserts that left is not equal to right or panics with an optional message. There are a couple of restrictions with the assert macros. Values used must implement partial EQ and debug. Most built-in types already implement both, and we'll talk about how to implement them for your own types in the traits video. To run our test in our project, we use cargo test. When we do that for this test, we should see this. This top bit is a summary of all the tests, then we get a breakdown of each test that failed. You can see that we get both the line where the test failed in addition to our failure message. The line number is why a lot of people skip the message, but it can still be useful to help provide context before we need to look up the line. Let's move on to writing our actual tests. We'll start with split at. Before we can write a test though, split at is not part of the test module, so we need to make it available inside. We can do that with the use keyword in one of two ways, either use super split at or use super star. The super keyword simply means the module above this one, which for your unit test should be the module that you're writing the test for. We can either bring in just one function or we can bring in everything with super star. The idiom here is to use superstar, as it will bring in everything that needs to be tested, and hopefully, even if it brings in things you aren't using, won't pollute the test module too much. With our test, let's use hello world as the input string, and we'll split at 3. So we can expect the left side of the split to be hell, and the right side of it to be low world. I've added some context to our assert so that we can quickly see if anything went wrong. When we run cargo test, everything passes, which is great. However, because we're working with strings, we should check strings that contain more than just ASCII characters. Let's write another test for split at. This is exactly the same, but we've used hello world in Japanese. Hopefully. Let me know if I've got it wrong in the comments. Now, when we run the tests, this test fails. This is where testing gets really nuanced. We need to test our expectations of the behavior, not that the code did what we programmed it to. In the test, I wrote that I expected the result to be the first three characters, but in the last video, I mentioned that this was going to return the first three bytes. The Japanese character ko is 3 bytes in length, which is why it's the only character that's returned. If we ask for 2 bytes instead, the split's going to fall inside of a character, and this function would panic and crash our program. Regardless of that though, from the name split at, I think that the number of characters is the right behavior here. So let's fix our function. Don't worry too much about this yet, we're going to cover iterators in a future video, but to explain the fix. Chars returns an iterator over each character in the string. We then use take to take from that iterator, at most, the number of characters we wanted to split at. We then use map over each character to get its size in bytes, which turns the character into a useSize number. Finally, we sum the iterator, which adds every number in the iterator together. This turns the length in chars into a new length in bytes and will be the correct size regardless of what size each of those characters were individually. This is now safe to use to create our subslices as the byte count won't fall inside of a character. We also no longer need to check the bounds of split at either because the maximum size will be the full length of the string, even if split at was longer than the string. Let's rerun our tests and now this test works. But what if I told you we just did all of this backwards? Hopefully you're eager to write a load of code and then write a load of tests, but wait. As we alluded to at the beginning of the video and again about halfway through, the point of tests isn't to test that your code does what you think it does, it's to make sure it does what it's supposed to do. As our split at function showed, it's a good idea to decide what you think that function should do before you write it. The best way to achieve this is to work out what your code is supposed to do, then write the test, then write the code. This is called test-driven development. Let's try it out. We're going to write a function that checks if a given string is a palindrome, a word that's the same forwards and backwards. We'll start by writing our test. We'll check whether the function flags kayak and race car as palindromes and flags wood as not a palindrome. Before we can run the test, Rust's type system won't let us compile the program without the function existing. We don't want to write the functionality yet, so we'll create the function header and use the todo macro. Todo is a handy little marker for when we want to say that we are intending on returning to something soon. It always panics, so Rust knows our function doesn't need to return anything. We can run our tests now and see that they fail. Let's write the code. Like earlier, we'll get an iterator for each character in the string. We'll clone this iterator and reverse it, so we get a second iterator that goes backwards through the string. Again, don't worry too much about the hows and whys of iterators yet, let's just go with it for now. We can zip the two iterators together, creating a new iterator of tuples, where the first item in the tuple comes from the first iterator and the second item in the tuple comes from the second iterator. We can then compare them to each other. If every element in this new iterator has the left and right side be equal to each other, then the word is the same forwards and backwards. Now when we run our tests, they pass. We can now submit our code to a colleague for review. Hold on just one second. Excuse me, Indra, would you mind giving me a quick code review?
Yeah, sure. Looks good. Race car is a palindrome, but it's two words.
You are so right and wise. Thank you very much. Bye. Great, let's update the test. All we need to do is add a space to race car. Now our test fails again, which is great. Let's fix it. We'll update our first iterator to filter out anything that's not alphanumeric. That'll deal with white space and all other punctuation too. We only need to update the forward iterator because the effect of the filter is cloned into the backwards iterator. Now our test passes again. Let's go back to that review. Excuse the interruption again, I'm very sorry. Would you mind checking my changes?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Looks good. But have you thought about palindromes with mixed case letters, like names like Anna, for instance?
That's a great thought. I will get that sorted right away. Thank you very much. Sorry for wasting your time. Thank you. Bye. Okay, great. Let's update our test one more time. And again, our tests fail. Let's update our code. Now, the obvious thing to do here is to lowercase all the letters, but in some languages, an uppercase letter might have multiple lowercase variants, depending on how it's used. If we map over each character in the string and lowercase it, we actually get another iterator that contains each possible lowercase letter. This means we now have an iterator of iterators. We can get back to an iterator of characters by using the flatten method. And now our tests pass again. This function still isn't perfect, honestly, but we're gonna leave it here. If you want to keep working on it, it's worth looking at diacritics as well as the difference between balanced and unbalanced palindromes. If you were to do this, you might need to rely on an external crate for more nuanced control of Unicode characters. For test-driven development, the main thing I want to emphasize is that at each stage, we think about what we want to achieve, We write or modify a test to represent that expectation, and then we modify the functionality until the test passes. The perennial question when it comes to testing. How many tests should a good test writer write if a good test writer could write tests? Boom, first time. The important thing here is coverage. We usually measure coverage by lines. Each time we run a test, we can look to see if a line was run. If it was, we call that covered. Take, for example, this really silly function. If we only test the function by giving it a number greater than zero, we'll only cover the first branch of the if. We miss the fact that there's a mistake in the second branch. So what percentage of coverage should you be aiming for? Anecdotally, when I was creating my own API framework in PHP, I decided I wanted to get 100% coverage. That is, every line should have a test that hits it. The very last line that was uncovered was, in its entirety, this. I wondered if it was worth the effort and decided it was. The reason it was the last uncovered line was that it was part of a nested if. I tested what happens if you went into both ifs, what happens if you didn't go into the first, but not what happens if you went into the first and not the second. I wrote the test and found a bug so severe I had to rewrite almost a third of the framework. Should have written the test first, am I right? My personal feelings are that you as an engineer should strive for 100% coverage of your code. As a manager or engineering lead though, test coverage is a terrible metric. Test coverage doesn't tell you if the test was any good. If you make arbitrary metrics like this, you're not improving code quality. Engineers will write tests that meet the metric, but don't fulfill the reason we want the test in the first place, which is to answer, does this code do what we want it to do? As an engineer, it's a matter of pride. Get your code right now and you won't have to deal with it later. As a leader, make sure your engineers are encouraged to be the best that they can be. This means giving them the time to write the tests first and then giving them access to the resources to learn how to write the best tests. We've already let on how to solve last time's homework. We only needed one lifetime to represent the link between the input string and the string slices inside of the vector. For a cleaner and more efficient API though, you could keep our recursive function private and expose a public function that creates the vector for us. Because we have control of the vector in this example, we can make sure that we create a vector with a capacity that is at least as large as the maximum possible entries in it. This is useful as when you create a new vector in Rust, it has a default size, and any time that you try to add an item into a vector that is already full, Rust will allocate the memory for a larger vector in the background, copy the data from the old location to the new location, and then free the memory in the old location. This is all very time consuming. For the homework this time, I'd like you to write the tests for and then implement the code for the following requirements in this order. Create a function that will reverse the words in an English sentence. If the string started with a capital letter, it should still start with a capital letter after the words are reversed. If the string starts or ends with whitespace, that should be removed or trimmed from the returned string. If the string contains more than one sentence, the function should return an error, though for now that error can be the unit type. Your function is going to need to allocate memory and should probably have a header like this. I've linked to the documentation for string and result in the description of the video, which should help. As I mentioned, after this chapter we will be talking about Rust differently. This will primarily be by using the assert macros to state what a value should be rather than printing it to the screen. For example, one of our earlier code examples looks like this. We printed the values min byte and max byte to the screen. From now on, we'll write our examples like this, which, now you've seen the assert macros, is cleaner and easier to understand. This time we covered one of my favorite Rust features, testing. Next time, we're going to cover my number one favorite, documentation. Seriously, the documentation tooling in Rust is so good, it's going to make you wish every language did the same thing. If that's exciting for you, don't forget to like and subscribe. If you need any help with the homework, please do comment. I'm also going to be setting up a Discord server in the near future, so keep an eye out for that. And I'll see you next time.
Indra, who was that?
I don't know, but he sounded familiar.